We bring to this Congress is the case of a patient who was diagnosed in our hospital of an advanced inoperable neuroendocrine tumor and who received a treatment with lutetium oxidase, which is a type of systemic radiotherapy. So, our patient is a 60-year-old male who in 2002 presented to our hospital with symptoms consistent with a carcinoid syndrome. This syndrome was confirmed, as you know, through the determination of 5-HIAA in urine, and then we proceeded to the study of the disease. In first place, an hepatic ultrasonography was performed that showed some liver lesions consistent with hepatic metastasis. Then an scintigraphy with indium oxidase was performed and showed a high captation rate in the upper pulmonary lobe and in the whole liver. And finally, in order to stage and finally assess the disease, a PET-CT was ordered. And the conclusions of this study was that this patient was suffering from a primary bronchial neuroendocrine tumor that was resectable and with hepatic metastases that were neither suitable for resection nor for liver transplantation, as you can see in the CT, in the PET CT here. So the initial treatment that was offered to this patient was a palliative one rather than a curative one due to the advanced stage of his disease. And firstly, a right upper lobectomy, right upper pulmonary lobectomy was performed that was successful at resecting the whole primary tumor. And this surgery was followed by the systemic administration of the somatostatin analog octreotide that is the first line treatment for this type of cancer. The patient was followed up in our hospital, and in 2005, it was discovered that he had experienced a significant reduction in the size of his hepatic lesions. This is something which really took doctors aback because it just happened between a 0 and 17% of cases. It was almost a casual finding. It was nothing we pretended or doctors pretended when they started the treatment. So he was reassessed by the Department of Liver Transplantation of our hospital and that decided to whitelist him for liver transplantation at the beginning of 2005. And finally, this patient received a new liver in October 2005. He was followed up in our hospital and until 2008, when an scintigraphy revealed that he had metastatic disease in the spine, the ribs, both femora. This was a real problem because no, let's say, classical treatment available at our hospital was suitable for such an advanced disease. So he was offered the possibility of moving to Sweden to receive a new treatment based on the lutetium oxidase, which is a type of PRRT. I will explain later what this is. The patient accepted this option and received 5 cycles of this type of radiotherapy between 2008 and 2009. And this treatment was successful at stopping the progression of his disease, as you can see in the CT here, and improving the symptomatology the patient was presenting. He continued the follow-up, he came back to Spain to continue the follow-up, and even though he was diagnosed with some mediastinal metastasis in 2011, they were successfully treated by means of a mediastinal lymphadenectomy. And at the moment, this patient had an acceptable quality of life and his disease is stable in stage 4. Well, now I'd like to move on to the discussion of this case. Some of you may know what this lutetium oxidase therapy is, but some of you may not. So that's what I'm going to explain next. Lutetium oxidase therapy is a type of peptide receptor radionuclide therapy, which basically is a type of systemic radiotherapy administered intravenously. It's a type of radiotherapy administered intravenously based on the use of radioactive molecules which are composed of 3 different parts. And understanding these 3 different parts is very important to get to know how this type of therapy works. So, the first part of these molecules is a peptide somatostatin analog, usually octreotide, which allows this therapy to selectively target neuroendocrine tumors. The second part of the molecule is a chelator. The one which is more widely used is DOTA, and which basically acts as a bridge between the radioactive element and the somatostatin analog. And finally, we have the real therapeutic part of the molecule, which is a radioactive element in charge of releasing the therapeutic radiation that will kill, hopefully kill malignant cells. This radioactive element can be either indium, yttrium, or lutetium, which is the one that appears to be catching on in recent years. So the way this molecule works is because octreotide can selectively bind to the surface of neuroendocrine tumors because they express, these type of tumors express somatostatin receptors. And once the whole radioligand peptide is binded to the surface of tumoral cells, the whole radioligand peptide is internalized by the cell, and the radioactive part of the molecule releases the radiation which will kill the cell. The excess of lutetium octreotide is excreted via the kidneys, and I'd like to underline one fact, which is that lutetium has a tissue penetration of around 2 millimeters, which makes this type of radiotherapy very safe, since a very small amount of healthy tissue is going to be radiated and damaged around the tumor. Well, which patients are candidates for this type of treatment? Well, generally, this type of therapy is indicated in every patient with an advanced inoperable neuroendocrine tumor, which is either well or moderate or differentiated. Another very important point in order patients to be treated is that they must have a high uptake in tumor lesions in the diagnostic octroscan, because this result is related with the amount of somatostatin receptors on the surface of tumoral cells, and therefore with the amount of radioligand peptide that is going to be internalized by the tumor. It is even a factor of a good predictor of response to this type of therapy. And finally, I'd like to comment the results obtained by one of the first groups from the Netherlands that assess the results obtained with this type of therapy. In this clinical trial, 310 patients were evaluated with the following results. 2% of them experienced complete remission, 28% partial remission, 16% minor remission, and 35% continued with unstable disease. It means that almost in 80% of cases, the objective of oncologists of stopping the progression of the disease was successful, and just 20% of patients continued with a progressive disease. Some toxicity was described, but it was above all some mild adverse effects, very common with this type of treatment, such as nausea, vomiting, or abdominal pain. Just 3.6% of patients experienced subacute hematological toxicity that was more severe. And this group also described two prognostic factors.